Ariane 5, Long March 5, and another Falcon 9? All these launch now on kNews. Hi, I'm Lucas. Welcome to kNews for week 26 and a big thank you to all my kNews boosters on Patreon. This week's first launch is an Ariane 5 on June 28th at 20:59 UTC as always from Kourou in French Guiana. The 55-meter tall rocket is powered by two strong boosters, which account for the majority of thrust at liftoff, and a cryogenic core stage. The much smaller upper stage burns cryogenic propellants as well, which are of course liquid hydrogen and oxygen, and it carries two satellites. Below the Zilda cover is the smaller GZ-17 for India, and up top a so-called Condo set. As a native English-speaking person, you might understand that, but I had to do a little bit of research, aka googling. Condo or condominium is a real estate which gets split into multiple units which are each owned by different parties. Now it makes all sense since the bigger satellite up top is shared between two companies, Hellasat and Inmarsat. In the beginning I actually thought it was a typo and they meant CombiSat. The more you know. Anyways, as usual Ariane 5 will head east following the equator to shoot its payload into a geosynchronous transfer orbit with a periapsis of 250 and an apoapsis of 35,786 km. Kourou's proximity to the equator allows the rockets to launch payloads into low inclinations efficiently, leading to a final one of only 3 degrees. This means a satellite has to correct less of it and has more fuel left for an increased mission duration. Speaking of mission, both satellites will be utilized for broadcasting satellite TV but also other forms of communication like internet on planes. So, should you ever browse the web on a plane, it will be thanks to satellites in space. Just by the way, the Condo set will be placed at 39 degrees east, from where it will cover Europe, the Middle East and parts of Southern Africa, while GZ-17 will take seat at 93.5 degrees east, over India covering it, but also the Middle East and other parts of South Asia, with its services. Next up to launch is a Chinese Long March 5 on July 2nd from Wenchang City. China's heavy lift rocket will take off for the second time following its launch in November 2016. It is not only China's biggest, but also most efficient rocket. It uses two core stages burning cryogenic fuel, similar to Ariane 5, but has four side-mounted boosters, which is again similar to the upcoming Ariane 6. However, instead of burning solids on these, it uses kerosene, aka RP1. An optional addition is the third stage, which is only used to push satellites into a geosynchronous transfer orbit, but this one uses hypergolic propellant. On top, Long March 5 is one of, if not the heaviest satellite to be launched into such a geosynchronous transfer orbit. It has a mass of over 7 tons, although it's not 100% clear how much exactly, and is a testbed for all kinds of new technologies. The satellite is called Huijian 18, which means something like time 18 or maybe 18 o'clock, but I'm not sure. Since it is also a communication satellite, Long March 5 will head east and also achieve a geosynchronous transfer orbit. There are not many details published as far as I can tell, but China wants, for example, to test its latest electric propulsion technology using a stronger ion drive and laser communication. It's a little speculative, but such a laser link would be especially useful as an uplink to the satellite from a ground station, since a narrow beam is not really necessary covering a big area on ground, and it would also require all recipients to change the receivers. That's very unlikely, I would say. And the last launch this week again could be a Falcon 9 on the same day, just a little later at 23:35 UTC from Florida. On board this time is Intelsat 35E, and you know what that means. For a change it will head towards a geosynchronous transfer orbit. But seriously, it's actually one of those launches again where the Falcon will launch in its expendable configuration without landing legs. Yep, the booster will crash into the ocean and not attempt to land. The reason for that is the satellite mass of round about 6 tons. Launching from Cape Canaveral, its flight computer will as always lead the rocket east, tilting towards the darkening horizon. The satellite mass requires the first stage to give the upper stage an additional boost, which will again lead to the booster not having enough fuel for its entry and landing burn. I'm not entirely sure if SpaceX ever tried to recover a rocket without entry burn, but it seems to me as if they at least plan to reduce it as much as possible. The last Falcon 9, which launched from Wartenberg, was a new booster, probably the first Block 4, which is an incremental step towards the final Block 5 version of the Falcon. There are many under the hood changes, but the most prominent ones are the thicker shielding at the bottom and bigger titanium grid fins up top. These can withstand much more heat and will glow brightly, as Elon Musk indicated in a tweet. To me, this sounds as if SpaceX is going for hotter and more efficient booster landings. The grid fins also got bigger, which means they will gain more control authority, which is another indication for a shorter re-entry burn, since they had less time to correct the trajectory with the engines. Anyways, I hope everything will go according to plan on all these launches and that all the payloads reach their desired locations successfully. Good luck, everyone. Okay, that shall conclude episode 91, and I hope to see you next one if you like. Auf Wiedersehen and thank you for watching.